You like that song, don't you, Mathew? It's your theme song, isn't it?
Not quite.
You're the voice. Do you miss not being mayor?
No, I don't really miss it. It was disappointing that it ended the way it did. I think there was unfinished business there, and I think Dubbo certainly was going to continue to benefit under the current regime that we had at the time. And I think Dubbo certainly hasn't gained any benefits. I don't think Wellington's gained any benefits from the amalgamation. In fact,
it's going to take about 5 years, though, to recover.
Oh, well, but they were kind of then 5 years behind. I mean, I did a lot of research around amalgamations at the time, and I didn't find another council.
It's got to play that song that you and your daughter did. I thought I'd better not embarrass.
Yeah, but I couldn't find another council anywhere in the state that had been amalgamated and then could show some clear indicators that they were in front. So I think amalgamations are convenient, but I don't think they actually benefit the residents of Dubbo or Wellington, unfortunately.
Well, Paul Toole told me over and over and over and over again when he was Minister for Local Government, no forced mergers. What's he doing now?
Yeah, who knows? Moved him out of that department anyway, didn't they? Yeah.
Okay, before we get onto the Tour de OROC and sweaty saddles.
You like the idea of sweaty saddles, don't you?
Well, it turns me off.
I was a bit worried where you're going there.
Level 3 water. You don't reckon we should be level 3?
Well, no, the real issue for me is about the communication that we have around that. When we're communicating to Sydney metro areas, to national media outlets, that we're going to run out of water, that to me is an incredibly negative message.
That came off the back of an article in a Sunday paper.
Well, that's come off the back of commentary that we've had come out of this community, unfortunately, that said that we're going to run out of water. It's drastic. It's terrible. We're going to run out of water. And that sends an incredibly negative message. And then that's continued on.
And it can be blown out of proportion too by the media.
Well, that's exactly right. But the communication started off. Now, if the communication started off that we're being prudent and sensible and we're going to have some restrictions on water because it's very tight for water, if you communicated it correctly, it would be much better. But having said all of that, we're not going to run out of water. No. The Water New South Wales has given us a timeline. I've seen the timeline that said if we get zero rain, not a little bit of rain, zero across the entire catchment area, 13,900 square kilometres, for 12 months, then our river runs out. Now, that's 8 gigalitres of water we've got in our river licences. We're down to only 4 gigalitres in our underground bores. Now, 4 gigs is not a lot, don't get me wrong. We normally in Dubbo would use, say, 7 or 8 per year. So it would mean we'd be down to half, but half is not zero. So I've got businesses telling me now how much it's impacting them by people cancelling bookings, not coming to Dubbo. Their staff saying, I'm going to go and get another job out of Dubbo because obviously there's no water. I can't keep doing my job.
No.
So these are all incredibly negative impacts. And give it years down the track, people will be looking to come to places like Dubbo. We spent a lot of money in programs like Evo Cities. And I'll say, I'm not going there. They run out of water.
When you had your robes and your jingles on, I remember talking to you, Matt Dickerson, and you were saying that we lost $1 million because of water consumption. It went down, didn't it? Or something, you didn't get $1 million.
Yeah, that's another scenario altogether. That was when we were changing pricing to try and limit water consumption, and that did. That did reduce water consumption.
What's this going to do if we go under level 3 now and level 4? What's that going to do with the remuneration in the council for water?
Well, I think so far it's proven that water's gone up. When you've actually, in terms of the consumption, when you had level 2 come in, people went, oh, no, I better go and use that water up because I'm only limited a certain day. So it actually went up. So the data out of council said the water consumption went up. Level 3, again, some anecdotes from around the community over the last couple of days, people used a huge amount of water on the weekend because we were about to go to level 3. Yeah. Now, level 3, it depends. I mean, it's not really a sensible way. Now that we've got technology advanced the way it is or the point it is, there is nothing stopping us to say to the community, everyone must be using 10% less, for example, and we'll do that via your metering. Because having constricted rules, it doesn't stop you using certain amounts inside. No one's going to come inside and see, did you have a 5-minute shower today, Richard? Or you had 7 minutes?
3-minute shower this morning.
Yeah, so that's the thing.
You
there's
want to
nothing
come into my shower while I'm showering?
No. But that's the thing. Council's not going to do that, but they can do it via metering. That's so right. There are much smarter ways.
Here's a contest. Here's a contest for all Dubbo ratepayer residents. Where's your water meter?
Yeah, that's a good point too. We don't get cold enough now that we get our water meters frozen over.
No,
so.
Tamworth have got the idea. They put half tyres over their water meters.
People used to know.
They're under huge pressure now too.
That's right. But see, one of our competitive advantages, Richard, was that we spent the money on the infrastructure and made sure we had the licences to be able to have that competitive advantage over the Tamworths of the world.
Yeah.
We're losing all that.
That's it too. And where is your water meter? That's the challenge of today.
Well, I remember when I was a kid, sometimes it would freeze over, so you had to know where it was. But now,
295. That seems a lot to me, 295 litres. I've got two words for advice, though, man. Buy water.
Well, that's what people are doing. They're stockpiling water. And again, I think that's creating a whole range of false economies. I mean, if the state government was serious, they'd make it much easier to get grey water.
Look, John Barilaro said to me that if the plans for the Snowy Hydro were put on the table today, it would be rejected because there's no visionary. Yep. And if the electorate hasn't got a potential to go one way or the other in politics, oh, there's no point in putting money in that dam there because we don't need that seat. Yeah. Does it come down to that, Mathew Dickerson? I want to talk about OROC. Let's go talk about something positive. You're peddling away on Monday.
Monday.
9 to 9, by the way. Peddling away on Monday.
Peddling away Monday. So 7:29 a.m. we leave Macquarie Homestay. And that's the...
Isn't that great, that place?
Oh, it is fantastic. And look, very happy when we're up there at the opening this year. There was a lot of people that have been involved with OROC over the years to see the plaque unveiled for the first building called Tour de OROC. Oh, I think that was absolutely fantastic. And it's an indication of just how much hard work this particular group and this ride or this event has put into raising money. Almost $400,000 before this ride. It'll be almost $500,000 by the time we finish this ride.
Rod Crowfoot can't sleep at night, but it's a good not sleep.
That's right.
Which is pretty good. Dawn Findell, all that stuff. So you take off or you pedal out. How many are now on the saddles?
So we've got 15 riders on the bikes, okay. And we leave Monday morning, so public holiday. We watch the grand final on Sunday night, hopefully somewhere. And,
go
and
then, Raiders.
Yeah, that's right.
Are you going for the Raiders?
I actually do prefer the Raiders over the Roosters, unfortunately. I've got a good mate who's a Roosters fan, so he's not probably very happy with me. But it'd be good to see the Raiders are in, and good for Ricky too, I think.
Yeah, good for me.
Yeah.
I win.
Yeah.
So it's 7:29 out of Macquarie. Do you do it all in single file or what?
In certain parts we do. So when we're in a congested area, like a part of a town, we'll go single file. Then once we get out onto some open roads, we'll go side by side, so dual file, if you like. And we've got safety car at the beginning, safety car at the end. Support crew do a fantastic job. You get very well looked after on this event. You're sitting in the saddle riding, but the support crew get all set up and have it laid out for you. When you turn up to each stop, it's a smorgasbord for you. You eat, and then on you go again, and they set it all up.
It reminds me of the Zoo to Zoo, Mackay's thing, and also the car rallies. Every community comes out, big or small, to welcome you in.
Yeah, that's right.
So you go homestay. What's the next first stop?
So the first stop is lunchtime at Armatree Pub.
Good.
Right out.
Armatree Pub.
I'm a bit concerned about a few guys getting to the pub and going, oh, we're close enough, aren't we? So we're overnight in Canamble. And we've got some, like the GM of Canamble is going to come out and ride probably 30, 40 k's with us, maybe even more.
I thought you were going to say 30, 40 metres.
No. And we've got the mayors participating across the region as well. So some of them don't do quite as many kilometres, but the GM's out there and into it. Lightning Ridge at the end of day two. First year we've been able to organise Lightning Ridge because it's kind of a tricky spot to get to.
It is like red stuff.
Yeah.
And look out for Stanley, the big...
We drove the circuit only a month or so ago, and Stanley's one of our stops. So I actually had coffee with Stan Single the other day, and I told him one of our stops was at Stanley. I tried to encourage him to come out there and be there for us when we make a stop at Stanley.
So here, Armatree Pub.
Yep.
Four-day night stay there.
No, hopefully not. And then in the car the rest of the way. Yeah,
then off to Lightning Ridge.
So Canamble overnight the first night, Lightning Ridge overnight the second night.
Third
night we end up in Bourke. So that's too far to get on a bike. So we've actually got something new this year. We're doing a bus trip for 100 kilometres of that so that we can fit in Lightning Ridge. It was the only way we could see we could fit Lightning Ridge in.
Long ride.
Yeah.
Okay. So what happens to the bikes?
So we've got a trailer. Zoo to Zoo has lent us a trailer, and that fits all the bikes in there. So it's a fantastic trailer that was custom built for bike rides. Yep. So Bourke overnight, then we end up in Cobar the next night, then Warren. Now that'll be a big night in Warren because Mike Tomalaris from SBS is coming along as our guest rider.
Yep.
He's joining us in Ningen, riding into Warren. Overnight function in Warren on the Friday night.
Is Greg Store going to sing in Warren?
Yeah. Who knows what's going to happen in Warren? They have it all organised. We'll turn up. They'll have a fantastic event there. They'll raise a heap of money. And then the last day, coming back into Dubbo, if people want to be there to welcome us, about 3:19 p.m. approximately at Macquarie Homestay on Saturday.
Okay. Yeah. The whole circle. All right. If we can participate, how can we join in on this?
If you go to givenow.com.au, you can still take donations or make a donation there. That's just Tour de OROC. You search for Tour de OROC. And so that's the easiest way to do it. Along the way, there'll be events everywhere, so anyone in the listening area can come along to any of those events, turn up to any of those council areas and participate in lunches or dinner time events. But the donation on the website is probably the easiest way to do it. We've got all our sponsors. We've got our jerseys being printed. That'll break another Guinness World Record.
Good.
And I'm incredibly impressed with people in the region because we're doing it tough at the moment. It's an incredibly tough drought we're in the middle of, hopefully at the end of, but we seem to be in the middle of it. So far, we're up to $76,000 raised. And our target's 100. I don't know if we'll hit 100, but having 76 at this point is an incredible effort for all those people.
Now, do you want to name and shame those who promised and not giving yet?
Richard Perno, Brett Murray.
Dallas Wall.
That's right. No, everyone's been really generous. It's been great. What I have noticed this time is that effectively people that have donated large amounts last time, this time they've still donated, but they've just dropped the amounts down a little bit. And again, it's tough out there. So,
Mathew Dickerson, Tour de OROC. What's that site again?
Givenow.com.au, and then if you just search for Tour de OROC once you get there.
All right, we'll talk again.
Thanks, Richard.
Restrictions are in effect.